You guys are very, very, very lucky, and I'll tell you why you're so lucky. You're about to listen to a keynote presentation by Wendy Kopp. Now, I remember when I worked on my undergraduate senior thesis some years ago. I believe it had something to do with Greek Cyprus and some kind of other thing that I've totally forgotten about completely. It had no significance on the world, nor should it. Whereas Wendy Kopp, in 1989, wrote a senior thesis that is now a vast organization with 24,000 alums and that currently has 9,000 core members in schools across the United States. And what are these core members doing? They're not teaching students how to gamble and how to engage in knife play. Rather, they're teaching students how to learn and how to love learning. The organization is Teach for America, and Wendy Kopp is going to talk about how some of her core members are deploying educational technology, how it's transforming classrooms, and it's going to be a really rad discussion. So please, let's have a round of applause for Wendy Kopp.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Well, first of all, I have to say a quick thanks to Google, which is making it possible to accelerate the impact of Teach for America here in the United States, but is also helping us accelerate the impact of this model now all around the world through growing the Teach for All network, which is now 23 organizations strong. And I think, you know, over the last, 22 years in this now, we have grown just ever deeper in the conviction that, first of all, we absolutely can solve educational inequity, the fact of kids' backgrounds predicting their educational outcomes, something that is so true here in the United States, but also true all around the world. We see evidence every day, not only in classrooms, but now in whole schools and even in whole school systems that are making dramatic progress, that it is possible not to make incremental progress against this problem, but to truly, ultimately solve this problem. And everything we've seen has reinforced our conviction that in the end, the most enabling ingredient is leadership. Ultimately, wherever we see meaningful change for kids, whether at the classroom level or the school level or the system level, always it is about deeply committed leadership. And that is the core mission of Teach for America. It's the mission of all of the programs that are united by the Teach for All network. Each of them are working to enlist their country's most promising future leaders in this effort through inspiring them to first commit 2 years to teach in their highest need communities, investing in their development, and ultimately fostering their leadership as a force for change working from inside and outside of the system. So we're envisioning a day, and truly it wouldn't be possible without Google's support, when all over the world we have thriving movements that are drawing our most incredible minds and top talent against such a fundamental issue in such diverse cultures, which inspire different ways of thinking. And we're envisioning getting to the point where 20 years from now, we have thriving movements, not only in the United States, but all over the world that are moving ever more quickly because they're informing each other to expand educational opportunity and ensure that the educational disparities that have persisted to this point are actually closed. So I have been asked to address the topic of educational technology. Just from our perspective, from what we see in classrooms and communities across the country, what do we think about its potential? And I want to say a bit, both about its incredible potential to absolutely revolutionize education and in turn, of course, our overall welfare, but also about the risks I see and the risks that I think we need to keep in mind as we endeavor to use technology to affect the changes that we need to see. I think it's important to step back and just ensure that we've all got the same context in our minds when we think about using technology in education. And you know, this is a context that, in essence, requires dramatic change. We have to get ourselves out of the incremental. You know, our work is all in urban and rural schools in the United States and now high poverty communities across the world. And, you know, the dramatic nature of the problem in our communities, it's almost impossible to believe, but a fifth of the kids in the United States are growing up below the poverty line. Half of them will not graduate from high school at all. And you can imagine what that sets them up for. The half who do, who we applaud for walking across the graduation stage, have an eighth grade skill level compared to kids in high income communities. So we live in a country that, despite aspiring to be a place of equal opportunity, the reality is that where you're born totally determines your prospects. 8% of our low income kids will have a college degree by the time they're 24 versus 80% of our top quartile kids. So this is a problem of enormous magnitude in the communities where we're working. But the state of our overall education system in the United States is also, as I'm sure this group knows, in need of huge repair. Only one third of U.S. students meet proficiency levels, not advanced levels, but proficiency levels in reading, math, and science. One third. It's sort of like those are the basic, you know, if you've got these state tests and you say, well, you know, you want your own kids to score on a 1 to 4 scale. I don't know, you want them to be advanced, you want them to be a 4. A third of our kids are at a 3 or a 4. I mean, this is our country. And you can see it in the international comparisons where of all the industrialized countries, the U.S. ranks 14th in reading, 25th in math, and 17th in science. So here in our country, we have a need for radical change. And what I've discovered in the early years of Teach for All is that the dissatisfaction that we feel here is felt deeply all across the world. Ironically, even in the countries that are ranked ahead of us, there's still deep dissatisfaction with the nature of education. And as I mentioned before, I mean, I've been shocked to see the extent of educational disparities around the world. We talk so much about India, for example, as a place that, you know, is providing competition for jobs and whatnot, and I'd never been to India until I went there to help with the development of Teach for India, and I was shocked to realize that we're talking about 3 or 4% of the population that is getting the kind of education that would enable them to get jobs like those that any of us in this room have. Even in the most developed cities in India, 60% of the kids are living on the streets and are certainly not attaining the kind of education that sets them up to have full choices. So we have a very big problem in education. That's the bottom line. And given the magnitude of that and the consequences of that problem, we have to embrace the idea that, you know, we need to effect truly transformational change in education. And of course, technology is one of the most powerful enablers of transformational change anywhere, in any sector, in any industry. And so, of course, we should embrace it in education. And it's kind of stunning to see how little we leverage the power of technology. So I wanted to say just a bit about, you know, based on what I've seen, what I've learned from our teachers and in our classrooms, I guess the ways in which I could imagine technology being pretty revolutionary. The first of them, so three big thoughts, and this is really only the tip of the iceberg, and I actually think the people in this room will have such incredible ideas about how to leverage technology to improve education. So my first thought has to do with, I mean, one of the things we've discovered in our work over time is how kind of revolutionary it is to get the kids to understand kind of where they are educationally and to give them a sense of where it is that they should be and should be on a mission to, and to empower them to essentially track their own progress. I wish I could just kind of take you to any given Teach for America person's classroom in the Bay Area right now, because I think you would sort of see firsthand, sort of shocking. I mean, it doesn't matter if it's in a first grader's classroom or a seventh grader's classroom or a junior in high school, you realize that, wow, there's something really powerful in this. Like, you know, you can get kids working with you, and teaching is a whole lot easier if you, like, are just really clear with them about, you know, here's where you are, here's where you need to be at the end of the year. If you get there, it's going to make a meaningful difference in your life and empower you with the information to actually, you know, track and own your progress to the goals. And I think about that as it relates to technology, because we live in a system now where kids are pretty much in the dark. Most kids don't know. I mean, one of the things we do at Teach for America is try to help our teachers understand the power in this. And so they're using all these manual systems to do it, and they're trying to bring parents into the process as well, because most of our parents are in the dark, and it does not matter. Low-income communities or high-income communities, most parents have a pretty vague understanding of where their kids should be educationally versus where they actually are. So you start thinking about the power of technology to actually get everyone on the same page, from teachers and the administrators in a school to the kids themselves to the parents. I just think this could be one of the most incredible accelerators, actually. As we get clearer and clearer, thanks to the Common Core knowledge standards, as the effort to develop much better measurements and much better assessments, which is, you know, we're in dire need of doing, and we will do. You know, as we do that, we need to figure out, now, how do we get all that information into the hands of our kids and our parents? And I think that will just hugely increase the levels of investment in education and motivation that we see on the part of our kids. The second category of things, and this is sort of to state the obvious, but technology clearly could be an incredible instructional tool for teachers. It is so underutilized now. And I think about, it's not utilized at all, essentially. And of course, there are the innovations that we're all really excited about, and the Salcons of the world and whatnot. But we're in early days in terms of seeing anything like that. I constantly talk with the most successful of our teachers, and, you know, of course, alongside many others of Teach for America, try to understand what is it that they're doing differently. And one thing that you become very struck by, like if I brought our, 10 most successful, second year Teach for America core members together and you started talking with them, you'd hear them saying, we're not great at instruction. They're just not. You know, how would they become great in their first year of the classroom or their second year of the classroom, like truly, truly great, so that every day when they're teaching any given skill or any given like piece of knowledge, they've got the very best of the best ways of teaching that. They've pretty much just, they do their best, but they're not trying to be great at that. What they are is incredible culture builders. They are incredible at stepping back and asking themselves the question, what am I going to do this year with my kids that's going to make a meaningful difference for them? And building the relationships with their kids and having the conversations with them and their parents that lead them to be on a mission to get to that end. And the fact that they've got their kids on a mission enables them to sort of not be perfect instructors and still have the kids make a lot of progress. But you start listening to them and spending time with them, and some of these people are extremely, extremely rare people. We have 3.7 million teachers in the country, and of course, some of them are very rare and some of them are less rare, just as is the case in any industry. And so you start thinking, wow, like, we could do so, it's actually crazy that we're not using technology so that in a way that enables math teachers to say, let me go online and find the very best way to teach fractions and bring that into my room, et cetera. So there's just a world of progress to be made there. I think another thing that just becomes really clear when you start talking with these teachers, and especially I think maybe in the communities in which we're largely working, teachers' greatest challenge is figuring out how in a classroom of 30 kids or however many, how do you differentiate your instruction appropriately to actually meet every given kid where they are and move them ahead to the maximum extent? And it's just downright impossible when you've got a whole group instruction going on, and technology can be And there are certainly many innovations going on to try to figure out how do we use technology to give teachers the tools that they need to differentiate instruction. And then finally, and as a parent, like I watch the addictive power of technology among my own kids and just think, wow, like what if we could put all that positive energy that goes into these computer games to some educational value. So I just think a lot about how underutilized the power of technology is, just given everything I've seen. And the final thing, and something that's particularly relevant here in California, is just, you know, we can use technology to save money. And, there's a network of schools here, which some of you may be familiar with, called Rocket Ship, that is one of the most successful networks of schools serving low-income kids. They have just off-the-chart results. And the thing that's enabling them to grow as quickly as they are, to invest more in their teachers' salaries, more in their teachers' professional development, is that they are utilizing the instructional technology that does exist, and they'd be the first to say that they can't wait for it to get better and better over time. But they are utilizing that to give their kids the basic skills that they need, and so they're freeing up dollars that would otherwise have gone into additional teaching positions and reinvesting it in ways that really drive quality and that enable them to open more schools for the very long waiting list of kids who are waiting in line. So there are numerous benefits, no doubt to state the obvious, to thinking deeply about how we can utilize technology to make the progress that we need to make in education. At the same time, as we think about diving into this, I do spend a fair amount of time thinking about the very significant risks. I think if you go to the big philanthropic conferences right now, and there's a bit of a fad about, educational technology is the answer. I mean, I've had my fair share of donors say, we're shifting our priorities, we're going to focus on technology. And they'll give me the lecture too, even about how we're sort of, if we embrace technology, versus just like thinking that we're going to solve all this problem through teachers alone. So I mean, there's a lot of momentum in this direction right now. And one of the things, and the thing that primarily just sort of scares me about it all, is that like the history of education reform in the last 20 years that I've been part of this, it is a history of an incredible lurch from one silver bullet solution to another. I mean, you can name the years. And if you go back far enough, there was the year of the project-based curriculum around when I was just getting started. We've had the years of the charter schools and the years of the give every parent a voucher. And I mean, really, it's just a huge lurch. This is the year of the teacher, if you haven't noticed. Fix the teachers and we could fix the problem. And I think once you get into it, you realize this is not about any one thing. This is about bringing the principles. I mean, I've come to understand what I really believe it will take to get where we're all trying to go is by spending time in the now, say, 400 incredibly high-performing schools in low-income communities that are putting kids whose background would predict one thing, and they're putting them on a very meaningfully different trajectory. I mean, setting them up to have full access to four-year colleges and to all the choices that really all the studies would say that shouldn't be possible for all the kids in all of these buildings. And when you spend time in these schools, you realize this is not about any one thing. This is about a school that has embraced a very different mission than most schools have. It's a mission that's not about putting learning opportunities in front of kids, but rather about ensuring that every single kid gains the academic skills and the character strength they need in order to get to and through college. And there's a school leader in that building who is on a mission to get there and does what any great leader does when they're pursuing a really tough mission. They are super focused on building a strong team. They are obsessing about how to recruit the teachers they want, how to develop them every day to get stronger as a team. They very intentionally build a powerful school culture that aligns every person in the building, the kids' parents, and the teachers on the same mission. They manage aggressively and effectively, and they do whatever it takes. They realize we need to lengthen the day, we need to bring in additional supports and services for kids, whatever it takes. So you think about, okay, so there's nothing magic to this. This is about good leadership, strong teams, strong cultures, all the things that actually we know account for success, you know, in anything. And so that influences me a lot. And I feel like I've actually firsthand seen the danger in assuming that technology can be the thing that just solves all of our problems. And actually there's a school in Philadelphia called the School of the Future that, you know, a very well-intentioned big technology company a few years ago, not that long ago, 7 or 8 years ago, decided that they were going to put some of their best people on the project of, you know, redesigning the school using all the latest technology. They invested tens of millions of dollars in it. They built a whole new building, you know, equipped for all the greatest technology. And this school has actually managed to underperform the Philadelphia public schools. And if you go into it, and I went and visited last year, and I observed the one classroom that's open to the public with the one teacher who's been there since the beginning. And I think, I mean, maybe we would have thought it was funny, actually, if you didn't very soon realize, like, this is like life or death for the kids in the class. I stood in the back of the class while this poor teacher tried to talk really loudly to get through this math lesson, and I looked at every single kid in the class, and I'm not exaggerating, and I made sure to get my facts right because I wrote a chapter on this in my book. Every single kid was doing one of three things. Two of them were, like, trying to get the computer to work. The others were either surfing the internet or IMing their friends. And I think, I know it sounds like a really extreme example, but actually, I feel like this is the kind of thing we see over and over and over. Technology can be so powerful, it's fundamental. I don't think we'll ever solve this problem, given the magnitude that it exists at, if we don't bring technology in. But we can't bring it in without recognizing all the fundamentals and ensuring that it's one part of this larger solution. And, you know, I ran across this quote some time ago from Steve Jobs, and I thought it was just so incredible that, you know, he sort of really got this. He said, "It is so much more hopeful to think that technology can solve the problems that are more human and more organizational and more political in nature, and it ain't so. We need to attack these things at the root, which is people and how much freedom we give people, the competition that will attract the best people." He said, "I feel very strongly about this. I wish it was as simple as giving it over to a computer." So those are the things I think about when I think about, you know, the need to undertake a technology revolution in education. We do see every day in our classrooms that kids have just enormous unfulfilled potential. I mean, they do in the classrooms in which our Teach for America core members are working. I look at my own kids in their classrooms and, you know, they're going to be fine, but there's no doubt we are not pushing the limits of our kids' potential. And I think that technology can be a critical lever in unleashing that, just as it's been proven to be a critical lever in revolutionizing pretty much every industry. But we do need to be careful. And I think my biggest one piece of advice would be to ensure that the incredible educators out there, meaning like the folks who actually are unleashing their kids' full potential, they're rare souls out there. I mean, I've had the privilege of spending time with some of them. I mean, not every Teach for America core member is one of these rare souls, like, but there are some of them who operate out of just deep love for their kids and are brilliant and have figured out how to get their kids to truly maximize their potential. And when I think about, you know, technology innovations that are developed under their watch, I don't worry at all. And so I just think there are implications of that. Like, I would just make sure that our very most successful educators are just deeply, deeply connected to this effort. And then I just know that technology will be, in fact, fully leveraged, fully maximized, and within its proper context. So I'll just close by saying that, you know, if I've learned anything in the last 20 years, it is that it is actually within our control to solve educational inequity and to increase educational quality across the board. We can realize the day when all of our nations and even our world's children attain an excellent education. There's nothing elusive about the solution. The question is simply, and this is a big question, you know, whether we will throw everything we've got at the problem. All the human resources we need, all the technology resources we need, and all the lessons we've learned in going after tough problems in any endeavor. So this means that the folks at Google and the folks in this room have just an immense amount to contribute. So I can't wait to see. I'm so optimistic about what the coming years are going to bring in this educational revolution that's already underway, and appreciate the time with you today. So thank you.